Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Welcome back. This is End Times Prophecies with me, your host Sheikh Fahim of the Islamic Lifestyle Solutions, on a program dedicated to the analysis of the signs of the end times. Before the break, we introduced the subject of signs and conditions. Now, there are many scholars, as previously discussed, who have dedicated much of their time to the subject of eschatology. For instance, Imam Nu'aym bin Hamad, in his Kitab al-Fitan, considered amongst the teachers of Imam al-Bukhari, dedicated a specific book to collating a hadith in which the Prophet, peace be upon him, had discussed the subject of the signs of the end times. We have famous scholars, the likes of Imam al-Qurtubi, who wrote the famous work Al-Tadhkira, which was an all-encapsulating book on the subject, but of course dedicated a huge amount of the subject matter to the prophesied signs. We also had in the latter days Imam Jalaluddin al-Suyuti, rahimahullah, who wrote various treatises on the subject as well. And of course, in the not-so-distant past, we had the famous Imam Muhammad bin Abdul Rasul al-Barzanji, rahimahullah, who also elaborated. And of course, scholars continue to follow upon the works established by the scholars of the past. Nonetheless, as mentioned, that I found a huge gap in the subject of identifying the conditions which necessitate a particular sign. Now, what do we mean by this? Well, an example that can resonate with us is a person driving along a road, and let's call it the freeway or the motorway or the highway, whatever suits your fancy in your locale, in your term. So you're driving along the motorway and you're traveling to a specific destination which you have not traveled to before. So what does the driver do? The driver is constantly looking for the signs, because the signs, the road signs, allow the driver to navigate the path appropriately. It gives you direction, so you know which lane you need to keep on. Is there an exit up ahead? What is the speed to be maintained? You know, so as an example, if you didn't have these signboards or the road signs, as we call it, you would miss, you know, in all likelihood, if you haven't been to a particular place before, driving for the first time, a huge possibility of missing the correct exit. I mean, how would you know to slow down if you're driving at 120 kilometers per hour, 60 miles per hour, and your exit is merely 50 meters away? How would you know to reduce your speed? So the signs allows a person to navigate the path. This is exactly what the Prophet, peace be upon him, in all probability alluded to by telling us that certain signs we should be looking out for as a means for us to put on the brakes, to reflect, to indulge in introspection, as a means of meeting the sign and acknowledging the sign and the implications of the sign. And the greatest of implication is once the signs are fulfilled, as the Prophet, peace be upon him, had mentioned too, that once they start arising and manifesting, they would fall like the way the beads fall from a necklace, one after the other. Now, what we fail to understand is, whilst it's really nice and really beneficial to have all these signboards placed up, but did the signs come up there on the motorway by chance? Did they overnight just appear by the click of a finger? Or was there work and effort to ensure that the signs actually were manifested easily in a point of view where the driver can actually see it without having to turn right or left and move his vision from the actual roadside? So when there's a sign placed up on a road, whether it's a warning sign, whether it's to reduce your speed, whether it's to indicate to you that there's an exit up ahead for your destination, those signs were actually placed there by a lot of effort. So there had to be a system in place, there had to be design in place, there had to be a sense of mentality of designing how that would be put there, and the effort in actually getting it to that point. So companies were created, job opportunities were created, a whole lot of things happened in the build-up to the sign. So the conditions actually act as a precursor for the actual sign, and this is also quite logical. Another example is the subject of riba, or what we call usually / in terms of understanding, the subject of interest in the world that we have today. We live in a time whereby interest-based transactions have become almost obligatory, without which you cannot function, but we'll come to that shortly. The Prophet, peace be upon him, prophesied the prevalence of interest. And he mentioned a quote in narration for you recorded in Abu Dawood as well as Ibn Majah. Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu is reported to have said that the Messenger said that there will certainly come a time for mankind when everyone will take interest, everyone will take riba, and if he does not do so, then the dust of riba will reach him. The Prophet, peace be upon him, some 1400 years ago foretold the time when interest, riba, would be widespread globally to the point that even if a person claims that he is free from riba, the dust of riba will reach him, meaning he is also part and parcel of that particular system. Now, 1400 years ago, a so-called man in the desert of Arabia foretold something as intricate in the financial system, in the monetary system, as worldwide interest-based transactions. Is it a fluke? Did he just make up something? Well, we'll let you be the judge of that when you analyze the thousands of other prophecies that he, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, foretold with precision. Now, coming back to the modern age, remember, our study of the subject of eschatology is to look at the signs to unravel the mysteries of the modern age. Currently, interest-based transactions have reached such a point. If a person wants to take out a mobile or cell phone contract for today, you cannot do so without providing a bank statement. These bank statements are a requisite, and there's no bank, illa masha'Allah, that does not profit from riba or interest, as we call it. Now, you want to buy a car, you want to buy a house, sure, we'll give you a loan. Sure, we'll help you get the money going. But in return, we will enslave you with interest. So even for the necessities of life today, it is almost impossible to stake the claim that I am free from riba. Even so, every single rand in South Africa, or dollar in your pocket, or pound in your pocket, or cents you want to call it, every single bit of that money is based on a system of interest. For the government requires money, so then it gives the order for the Reserve Bank to print money. But the Reserve Bank assigns to that particular note an interest amount, which then the government charges the people. So even every rand, every coin in your pocket is based on a system of interest. The Prophet, peace be upon him, foretold the prevalence of interest-based transactions some 1400 years ago. But within that particular prophecy was the underlying factor that not only did he, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, foretell a time, he also indicated to us that in order for that sign to become prevalent, you have to find the system that will be developed in order to ensure that time comes. So these are the conditions which need to be met. In the early 1900s, you find the system put in place after the Bretton Woods Accord, in which originally banks were started as a place to safekeep and safeguard your money for fear of bandits and robbers and looters. Eventually, it became very difficult to carry gold around. So they created a promissory note, which the bank gave you as an insurance that this particular money belonged to you. However, in order to issue a promissory note, the bank needed to have the gold in its vault. a time came where notes in the form of checks were issued in the first type of paper money, and there was a bit of a scam in which people started printing more notes than the gold that they actually had in their reserve. Till it came to a point that they were about to be called on their bluff, and overnight, in the Bretton Woods Agreement, they decided that money would no longer need to be backed by gold. So the money that we have today is of no intrinsic value. If you take gold, the value of the gold is in the gold. But if you take a piece of paper and you tear it up, it's nothing more than a piece of paper. It does not have any intrinsic value. And as the system progressed to develop, it reached a point whereby today money has no value. It's not even worth the paper that it is printed upon. So the Prophet, peace be upon him, in his infinite wisdom bestowed upon him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, infinite we say within creation, not to be compared with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet, peace be upon him, by explaining to us a prophecy pertaining to the prevalence of interest and interest-based transactions, he also told us of a time in which the world economy would be so engrossed in the subject of interest and riba, it would be inescapable. There are no government systems that are aligned with the modern world today that is free from the subject of interest, free from usury and riba. How true were the words of the Messenger, peace be upon him. Not only did he give us the sign, he also gave us the conditions. But as long as we continue to sleep, we will fail to stop the system before it reaches the next level. And who are we to even attempt stopping it as well when it has been prophesied by Rasulullah? But that being said, there should be an effort. And only when we identify the conditions which necessitate the signs will we be able to progress. So inshallah, in the coming episodes, we'll continue our discussion on ahadith, on the signs and conditions of the hour. Inshallah, till we meet again, if anything good has been achieved, praise belongs to Allah, faults belong to me. Astaghfirullah Rabbi min kulli dhanbi wa atubu ilayhi. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.